I guess, hadn't happened in Syria for a long time. And that was, they built some momentum. They were able to establish some economic growth. They were able to introduce things like healthcare policies, not Medicare as we have here in Australia, but some sort of health reform, infrastructure development. But for the first time in a long time, you know, we have a period of 400 years under Ottoman rule. We have another period of 40 or so odd years or 50 years under French mandate. And then for the first time in a long time, Syrian people actually were free from foreign intervention, free from foreign rule, and they were able to self-govern, self-determine themselves. And we know that during that phase, as I've said, and it's arguable and there's different statistics, but we know that Syria, for the first time, was able to grow and develop as a nation. If we are to criticise the Ba'ath Party, the one major criticism that we can come with is they were authoritarian. There was probably some policies that the Ba'ath Party or an approach that they had, which, as I said, was viewed negatively or in an authoritarian perspective. But for anybody who doesn't understand Arabs, I think personally, I think Arabs sometimes you need to sort of put the foot down. So, you know, but there's factors there as well that we need to look at. And you have to understand that at the time that the Ba'ath Party ruled Syria under Hafez al-Assad, we had tensions with Israel, we had a civil war going on in Lebanon. We had a lot of factors that may have influenced the decision of the Ba'ath Party at the time to have that authoritarian approach. You know, people ask, you know, all the time about, you know, what critiques can you come up with for the Ba'ath Party? I think that's the major one. But I always say, no government in the world is perfect. You know, today we live in a society where people are prejudiced based on their sexual orientation. You know, is that any different to, you know, there's people that are around the world who are prejudiced by the colour of their skin. You know, and when we live in a so-called free, democratic society. So under this period, we know, as I said, for the first time in a long time, Syria had some sort of stability, some sort of growth. There were benefits afforded to Syrian people as citizens. They could vote. As I said, they had access to health, access to other essential services and rights that Syrians were able to gain. But what I want to do is, I don't want to talk too much about that period again and the period of Bashar al-Assad. I actually want to fast forward to today. And I want to tie in, I guess, and say the reason why I spoke briefly on the Ottoman rule, the French mandate, and then the Ba'ath Party coming to power is if we look at events today in Syria, people ask me all the time, why would there be foreign intervention, or why would a foreign power want to intervene in Syria? You know, we can talk about conspiracy theories, and we can talk about a whole wide range of subjects. But in my opinion, it's almost, as I said before, history repeating itself. It's almost like a Sykes-Picot version 2. I think today we have to look at what the Ba'ath Party stood for when it came to power and those four main points: secularism, socialism, pan-Arabism, and freedom from Western influence. And the battle that's being fought in Syria today, in my opinion, is a battle of ideology. It's a battle that's being fought against those four essential principles. In 2003, we had a US President, George W. Bush, who openly said, "It is the dawn of a new Middle East. And if you're not with us, you're against us." And again, I don't want to talk about Iraq for the purpose of time, but we know that there was Ba'ath Party rule in Iraq, and they did share similar principles, but the United States and its allies were able to destroy a government, whether or not Saddam was a good ruler or not, that's not for me to say, I'll leave that to you. But the point is that there was a sovereign nation that was destroyed by a foreign power. And today we see the effects of foreign intervention in a country like Iraq. So today the United States and its allies fight to me, those four principles. Socialism is a dirty word in the West. We know that. It doesn't matter on what side of the scale you're on, unless you're, a far-right conservative, we may have an issue, but even on the left, there's a lot of tension politically in the world today. You look at, again, I don't want to get into too much detail, but we know that in parts of Europe, there are issues with different factions, different political ideologies, different views. But in Syria, we have a country that's a socialist government. Not only is a socialist, when many people, when we say the word socialist, a lot of people think, and I think it's a pre, and some of the older people would probably get this, but I think the first word that comes to your mind is probably Soviet Union. So people say socialist, Soviet Union, USSR, Cold War. Syria happens to have a Russian naval base. So, when the words Syria and socialism are put together, I think it may sort of send some jitters in some people's spines in Washington. But I think there's an ideological battle against socialism itself. And if we look at the allies of Syria, we know that they're socialist type allies, countries like China and Russia, there are others. But we know that there's that. I think it's a battle especially against secularism. If socialism is an abhorrent idea to the West, then I think secularism is an abhorrent idea to radical Islam. Because those in Riyadh and anywhere around the world who support Salafism, Wahhabism, any form of radical Islam, the biggest danger or the biggest threat you have to that specific ideology is a secular state. One of the things I think the Ba'ath Party was somewhat successful at, and I'll say somewhat because I think in Syria today, those who held on to the nationalism, the concept of nationalism and pan-Arabism are the ones who were able to deflect, this onslaught of radical Islam, etc. And today, Syria, I think one of the biggest misconceptions is that it's a war between sects. Or a war between religion or different groups. I think that's what the media want you to believe. It comes back to divide and conquer. Let's segregate a different group of people, make them fight each other, and it's easy for us to take over the resource, whatever the theory is behind it. But I don't think today that it's an Alawite v. Sunni war. I don't think it's a Shiite v. Sunni war. I don't think it's a Druze v. Maronite war. I think it's a war of ideology. It's those who believe in a nationalist approach, a secular Syria, versus those who want a radical Islamic Syria. And there are many Muslims, more Muslims today have lost their lives fighting against Daesh and against Jabhat al-Nusra and against other fanatical Islamic groups than probably any other religion in Syria or in the Middle East, for that fact. So I think there's two main ideologies being fought. Is there a fight against Western influence? Definitely. When I say Western influence, it's pretty broad. But when we talk about Western influence today, we can apply an economic approach. We hear a lot about countries with AAA ratings and AA ratings and B ratings or whatever it is. So here you have a nation that doesn't conform to this global US-led or Western approach to economy. Is that a reason, for example, to exert influence? Does it benefit the West to have a country there that follows Western fiscal policy and conforms to Western fiscal policy? I don't know, that's another approach. But in my opinion, the fact that today Syria aligns itself again with other socialist nations, governments, it aligns itself with groups like Hezbollah, who's a resistance group in the southern Lebanon. I think these things affect the West and again show that Syria is not one to follow Western influence or the exertion of its power. And we know, we heard Bashar al-Assad himself say in a very famous speech, I'm not made by the West, and I'm not a puppet to the West. So it was an acknowledgement there that Syria will not be made to conform or made to follow the Western version of democracy and freedom. You know, we heard a lot about as well at the beginning of the events that took place in Syria. We knew that something took place called an Arab Spring, which probably lasted, I don't know, for maybe a year or two. But the Arab Spring, to me, affected, I mean, we saw what happened in Libya, and I think at that point in time as well, we had an ally like Russia see what happened to Libya. And I think that, and I'll leave this for whoever talks about Russia, but I think that kind of poked the bear when Russia finally said, well, if the West and its allies can exert their influence or intervene militarily in a country like Libya, then maybe we're next on the radar. And we know, again, I don't want to get into the outside sphere, but we know that NATO has positioned itself against Russia, particularly all over the world. So, again, sorry for the time and if I've gone over, but I'll wrap up by saying that to surmise, I guess, what I was trying to say is that Syria, for 400 years, again, was ruled by the Ottomans, was ruled by the French, and then it suffered a period of instability. Then for 40 years, under the Ba'athist government in Syria, we had, for the first time in a very long time, independence for the Syrian people. We had some sort of stability, we had some sort of growth that took place. And then today, we almost have, or we don't almost have, we have foreign powers trying to exert a new democracy, a new form of freedom, which to me, or to any person with a brain that thinks for themselves, your version, the West version of democracy and freedom, shouldn't be exerted upon anybody. It should, the whole concept and notion of democracy and freedom is that it should be self-determined, it should come about from yourselves, right? Or as a people collectively. It shouldn't be something that's, this is what it is and this is what you have to do and this is democracy and freedom. To those nations that do that, I remind them, Washington, London, whoever it may be, Paris, it took you hundreds of years to develop the democracy and freedom that you have today and the governments that you have today. Syria has not been afforded itself that same opportunity. And again, I reiterate to those free-thinking people, even in the West version of democracy and freedom, we still see oppression, we still see injustice, we still see people, again, discriminated against by their sexual orientation or the color of their skin or by their race and religion. It exists. No government in the world is perfect. No government in the world is without fault. I thank you very much for attending this evening. And like my friend said before me, it doesn't serve the governments in the West to have an informed public. It's not what they want. You know, anybody who questions the narrative is labeled. But I thank you again for attending tonight, for opening your minds, and for understanding the narrative a little bit better from those who are Syrian and those who have been involved on the issue of Syria for a number of years. Thank you very much for your time.